June Bicorina opened a small stall outside his home after losing his job as a company driver at the height of the pandemic. He says life is getting better now, if not for high food prices.
Malaking epekto dahil yung una pag tumaas yung bilihin, kukunti lang yung kikitain namin. Dati ang bigas, magkano? Mga 40, 35. Ngayon, 50, pataas na. Mga sibuyas, di ba? Tumaas. Asukal, number one na rin yung asukal. Kasi yung asukal po, talagang isa rin siya sa mga kailangan natin na gamitin sa pang-araw-araw. So, malaking epekto. Malaking epekto sa kabuhayan.
Thelma Malonzo feels the same way. Her husband is a GT driver struggling to make ends meet for the family.
Kape, asukal, gatas, sabon pampaligo, sabon panlaba, yung mga toothpaste, mga shampoo. Yan, medyo tumaas sila. Pinagkakasya ko na lang yung kita ng asawa ko sa kasweldo ng anak ko. Kasi nga, di ba, nung pandemya, tambak ang bill namin, nagkanda utang-utang ako.
Many Filipinos are in the same boat, feeling the pinch of elevated inflation, which has proven to be one of the biggest economic challenges the Marcos Jr. administration had to face in its first year. Inflation steadily increased in the last quarter of 2022 and hit a high 8.7% in January this year, the highest in 14 years. Thankfully, it has steadily fallen, easing to 6.1% in May. However, that is still higher year on year. Economic managers attributed this to mostly external factors, particularly the Ukraine-Russia war, which affected global trade and international commodity prices. Some economists agree, but at least one says the spike in prices and supply issues could be due to neglect on the part of some officials, particularly in the agriculture sector.
Why did other countries manage to have lower inflation rates by the first quarter of this year compared to the Philippines? And the reason is the mismanagement of many or a few agricultural commodities. It's a combination of both bureaucratic inefficiency and malign intent on the part of certain agents.
To fight inflation, the Philippine Central Bank raised interest rates at an unprecedented rate, pushing it from 2.25% in June last year to 6.25% today. To counter the impact of monetary tightening and help the economy rebound from the COVID-19 pandemic, the government continued to reopen the economy. Full face-to-face work and classes resumed. Tourism was revived and many businesses opened. While this increased demand-side inflationary pressures, it also supercharged economic activity. Gross domestic product or GDP growth hit 7.6% for the full year of 2022, the highest in over four decades. That growth, however, was helped by a low base in 2021 when the Philippines was still affected by the pandemic. Still, economic managers hailed the Philippines' rapid growth, saying it is among the fastest in Southeast Asia. They also noted that the growth has helped cut down unemployment.
Bukas pa yung ekonomiya, wala nang restriction. At may, yung on the first year, isa sa i-highlight yun, talagang pinrioritize yung pagbukas ng ekonomiya. Ultimo yung pagsuot ng, yung wearing of mask, naging optional na yan sa latter part of October. Naging symbolical yun na policy priority yun na reopen the economy, wala nang COVID restrictions.
This year with the sharp economic downturn in 2020, remember that, huh? And so I think I would, and the unemployment still getting much better.
To sustain growth, President Marcos has gone on an aggressive international roadshow to woo foreign investments. 200 flagship infrastructure projects worth over 8 trillion pesos have also been lined up to further beef up the economy. These projects include airports, railways, bridges, and more. Finance Secretary Benjamin Jokno adds, with inflation easing, there is a room for the central bank to ease up on its monetary policy tightening.
Amid the bleak global economy, there are many good news for us. Okay? Notably, where the Fitch recently upgraded us. Okay, that means confidence. Prices are going down, which means maybe down the road, interest rates will go down also. Okay. In addition, the BSP just cut the reserve requirement by 250 basis points. That's fantastic. That means more loanable funds for businesses and consumers. Unemployment also went down. So there are lots of good news, okay? And lots of confidence from the international.
Some economists, however, are wary of the Philippines' high debt. They say debt in itself is not bad, but it should be used well. They also note there is a need to raise more revenues to help pay down that debt. The national government's outstanding debt hit 13.91 trillion pesos in April, a record high. It's been hitting record highs on a monthly basis, and over a trillion pesos of debt was added since President Marcos took office. 68% of debt is domestic, 32% foreign. Officials are not too worried. They say what is important is the economy is also growing and it will help the country outgrow the debt. The government also pushed through with its controversial proposal to help boost revenues and resources, the Maharlika Investment Fund, which the economic team says can bolster infrastructure spending. The first year under President Marcos has been a roller coaster of a ride for the economy. Hopefully, the next few years has more highs for more Filipinos. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.